place where kids will build, explore, and discover the memory of the ultimate creator, God. This is the Nerd Burn Factory. Kids discover that they were intentionally created, that God has a really big plan for their life.
I like seeing the kids that were inventors.
It's great to see kids' imaginations running wild.
I've never been to anything like this before.
It's amazing to think of the changes it's going to have on kids as they go back to their daily lives. They'll live differently, knowing that God created them and has a purpose for their life.
I can't wait to come back again.
Wow. Good morning. Doesn't that look like fun? Here's the sign-up in the foyer as well if you want to be a part of just even, you know, guys, fathers and sons, man, this is a solid opportunity to help fit helmets and lube up some chains and get things working right. I know sometimes things get rusted out over the winter. So be a part of that here this Saturday at 9 o'clock. And finally, next Sunday, we're going to be having our final food fundraiser for our Pine Ridge business trip. We're going to have Bruce Swanson's pulled pork, always a big hit, very fantastic, all the sides to go with it. All the money goes to the trip next weekend. And finally, I think our bulletin has a party this afternoon for Nathan Regeer. It's at noon to 4, not 2 to 4. So noon to 4 if you want to go to that. Let's go to our Father in prayer and get our hearts ready for worship today. Jesus, we're so thankful for you. Holy Spirit, we're so thankful that you've been sent today to celebrate Pentecost Sunday. And we're so thankful that you've sent the Spirit, Jesus, to be our power so that we can be your witnesses. We can testify with our lives of the goodness of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the transformation power of the gospel. God, as we worship you today, bring our hearts into alignment with you. Holy Spirit, bring conviction. Bring us to change and transformation today. Help us to do the work that you created us for, which is to magnify well the name of our living God. We surrender and yield ourselves to your leading today. In Jesus' name.
Now, as we continue our time of worship, Vangie's going to be sharing a little bit about her ministry in Pua. And as Micah brought up Pentecost Sunday, one of the things that happened at Pentecost, the Spirit filled the believers. They went out speaking all these different languages that everyone could understand. And one of the things that's still going on is that the Word of God is being translated into languages. And in Papua and Zintani is one place where there's a lot of translators and a lot of mission organizations there, and Vangie is serving them as a teacher, an educator, an administrator, and so she's going to come and share a little bit more about her work, and she is someone who we have sent out as one of our own and to represent us around the world. And so Vangie, thanks for coming.
All right, good morning, everyone. So good to see you and be back here, not like for a while. Grateful to be here, and I'm also thankful for your support and prayers over the 25 years I've been serving with Mission Aviation Fellowship. And it's such a privilege to represent you to the world, and especially in Papua. I'd like to start out with a video of just what it's like, what life in Papua is like. This is more from a pilot's point of view than a school teacher's point of view, but it's still a pretty cool video, so. Thank you. live in a beautiful spot. Yeah, I love the place where God has placed me. It is so incredible. The purpose of MAF is to share the love of Jesus through aviation and technology so that the isolated peoples in the world may be physically and spiritually transformed. And most of our pilots have families, and like families everywhere, they want their children to be well educated. And so MAF has teachers that come in different parts of the world and help to share the love of Jesus to the children so that the parents can share the love of Jesus through their ministries. The school that I'm at, Hillcrest School, is a school that was founded by 9 different mission agencies, so they didn't have to send their children outside of Indonesia for school. And it started as a Christian Missionary Alliance school in the 1960s, and then as the Alliance lost most of their visas at one point in the 1980s, it became a mission control school. So we have a board formed from all of these mission agencies that are working in Papua. And this year we have 120 students in our school, kindergarten through 12th grade. And for most of the time I've been with MAF, I've been a teacher. I've taught in one-room schools in various places. I've taught everything where I am now at Hillcrest. I've taught everything from first grade to through high school, the whole gamut. I prefer middle school. That's really my favorite age to teach. And but now the last 3 years I've been moving into administration. And as an administrator, you know, your role changes. You're trying to provide opportunities to support the teachers, to encourage the students as a whole, not just teach one particular class. And there's definitely been challenges to being an administrator, but I've enjoyed it for the most part. And God has, I think, prepared me for this and is using me as an administrator, even though it's not quite as hands-on with the kids. But one of the things that I've really enjoyed that I've gotten to do is I've gotten to be part of teams that go to other schools and evaluate them for their accreditation. Our school is accredited with the Western Association of Schools and Colleges here in the United States. They accredit schools and colleges on the West Coast, and then many international schools around the world are accredited by this organization. And so I've been on some teams with them and with ACSI, the Association of Christian Schools International, and I've gotten to go to 2 schools in Indonesia, 2 Christian Indonesian schools, which is really cool because Indonesia has the largest population of Muslims than any other country in the world. And yet there's some huge Christian schools in Indonesia who are proclaiming the gospel to their students, and not just Christian students, but to Muslim students too. And we also, one school that I was at to do their evaluation was called Ikthu School. And they used to be known as ISIS, but they decided that maybe they should change their initials. So they just go with the whole thing now, Ikthu School. And their goal is not only to give the people, this school is located in Jakarta, which is the capital of Indonesia. So they're not only trying to give a good education to the children there in Jakarta, but they're reaching out, especially to Kalimantan, which is the part of Borneo that belongs to Indonesia, and starting schools and helping, because in a lot of places in Indonesia, when you get away from the capital city, the more remote areas like where I am, the educational system really is not very good at all. And so they're trying to help and reach out to areas that don't have very good schooling for the children to give them better schools, and Christian schools too, in more remote areas, which I think is really cool that we have this school who's developing leaders for Indonesia is also reaching out to other parts of Indonesia with the love of Christ and sharing a good education with those children. So that was fun. And I also got to visit a school in Cambodia, in Phnom Penh, which was really cool. And they're connected with a school up in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania area. And they're also a Christian school. This school is a little bit unique because they teach their classes in three languages. So all of their children will be learning Cambodian. I forgot they have another word for it. So the Cambodian language, they're also teaching in English and also in Mandarin. So by the time those children graduate from that school, they're fluent in all three languages because they have to take classes in all three languages. So I think that's kind of a cool thing. But this school is also reaching out to the children of the leaders of the country of Cambodia and instilling in them the love of God. And I think that is so cool that they're doing that. So God's at work around the world through education. One of the things in my role as an administrator is to prepare our missions emphasis time. Every fall semester we have a spiritual emphasis time which teachers and actually our high school students do for our elementary students, and the teachers do it for the middle school students. But I get to plan the missions emphasis time, and you think, well, the missionary kids, why do they need a missions emphasis time, right? Well, they do, because there's more to being a missionary than being a missionary kid. as fun as that is, and as challenging as it can sometimes be. So we do different things to try to teach our children in our school about missionaries. Like once we had an emphasis on China, what's God doing in China? Sometimes we focused on the roles and jobs that the missionaries in our community have as Bible translators or pilots or youth workers. What do they do? How are they working? How are they fulfilling the Great Commission? 2 years ago, our mission emphasis time was Papua, then and now. And we kind of looked at what God is doing in Papua and how missions has changed over time. And so one of our speakers was an older couple. They're probably in their, I'm guessing they're close to 80, if not above 80. And they're still ministering to the people of Papua. They came there as young adults with a young family and have ministered to the people in Papua. They've done Bible translation. And so it was fun to hear from them how things have changed in the 50, 60 years that they've been in Papua. What did it look like back then? What does it look like now? But one of the most exciting stories we heard that week was from Kelly Reynolds. Kelly and her husband Chase are from Arkansas. They're with Wycliffe Bible Translators, and all three of their boys are in our school. And they are working with the Yefta people. And the Yefta people were discovered in 1992 in a small tribe. And I don't know if you noticed in the video, there's these huts with a thatch roof. They're round. And when you look at them from the air, they look a lot like mushrooms. And the Yefta people would, usually they build in small villages and they're scattered and they're easy to see when you're flying. But the Yefta people built individual huts or honais under trees and scattered. So they weren't clumped all together in small villages or large villages. So it was really, really hard for them to be found. So 25 years ago, there's still an unknown group that they found. And there still might be some unknown groups in Papua because it's such a remote area of the world. So when the people were found, there was an Indonesian evangelist named Pak Abi. And Pak Abi wanted to share the love of Jesus. The Lord laid it on his heart. He wanted to share the love of Jesus with the Yefta people. It took him 2 years to figure out how to get in there because he didn't know the language. So what he did is he got as close as he could get, and then he tried to find someone who knew Indonesian and that local language. And then they tried to find someone who knew that local language and the next language closer to the people. And so they finally worked their ways in like about four layers deep of people knowing this language and the next language, and then that language and the next language, till they finally found someone who knew Yefta and could talk through him. And so Fakadabi went in there and he started working with the Yefta people, learning their language, and as best he could, sharing the love of Jesus. Well, at some point, the Yefta people had heard that a neighboring tribe had God's word in their language. And they told Fakadabi, we want God's word in our language. And he said, well, if you want God's word in your language, you have to build an airstrip so that someone can come in and translate the Bible for you. So they started working. They worked for 3 years, day and night, with stone axes at the beginning, and stones, just stone tools, that's how primitive they were. Cutting down trees, they had found what Paka'abi thought would be a nice length of land between a river and a mountain. And so for 3 years, they worked day and night, cutting down trees, digging out the stumps, filling the holes, trying to make it smooth and level so that a plane could come in and they could have missionaries come and translate their language. And they got it all done, and they got a pilot to come and look at it, and the pilot flew over it, couldn't land right away because he didn't know how good the airstrip was. When he got back, he told Pakabi, it's long enough, but that mountain's in the way. We can't take off properly. So I'm sorry, we can't come in. And the Yefta people were devastated. They had worked for 3 years to build this airstrip so that they could have someone and translate God's word into their language. And Pakabi said, it's okay, let's pray. God says in his word that he can move mountains. Let's pray. And some of the people said, yeah, you pray, we're going to start digging. And they prayed. Do you believe that God can move a mountain? The Yefta people did. And Pakabi says that one day the mountain was there, the next morning the mountain was there. One day the mountain was there, the next morning the mountain was over here. During the night, God had moved the mountain, literally, so that the Yefta people could have the scripture in their own language.
Amen.
Yeah, exactly. And then Kelly was telling that story to our students. As soon as they heard that, they just started clapping and cheering because of what God had done. It was so cool for them to see. Yeah, God answers prayer. He even literally moves mountain. It's not a metaphor. He moved a mountain for the Yefta people. So Kelly and Chase and their family are in there. They're translating the scriptures. 5 years ago, they had a celebration of, 3 years ago, celebration of Pakabi first coming in there with the gospel. And by that time, they had 17 stories translated into, not the scriptures really yet, but stories translated into the Yefta language. So they had like creation and the fall and then the story of redemption. And in the process of that celebration, they told all 17 of these stories. And so God is at work building his love and his life into the Yefta people. And because our school is there to support the families can work with the people who don't yet know Jesus as your Savior. So that's part of what your prayers do. Your prayers and your support helps move mountains. It's pretty cool that we all get to be a part of that. As I said, I moved into administration. Now, the reason I came home in March instead of June was because my visa was up. Indonesia does not, they make all their teachers retire at age 60. And that's primarily so that the younger people can have a chance to get jobs and support their families, which makes sense, but not to me. I mean, I understand why they're doing that. But they also don't give visas to people over 60, to teachers over 60. And I'm over 60. And so I have no visa at this moment. We do have a visa has been applied for me, and I asked that it be that the age limit be waived for me. But this visa will be strictly an administrative visa, not a teaching visa. So far, it's going through the process, and the process to get a visa lasts for months in Indonesia. Right now, my application is sitting in military intelligence, and they will scrutinize all of my Facebook posts and any other social media, and they will make sure that I am the right kind of person to be in Indonesia. They're very, very careful, very thorough in their vetting process. And so we're waiting for God. So that would be a prayer request. Pray that if God wants me back there, that He'll supply that visa with the age waiver. Another prayer request would be for financial support. Because of various things, MAF raising their support level, many of my supporters, not many, but some, getting older and retiring or passing away. So some of my support has dropped. But God is faithful. He can supply that need. So if you just pray with me that God would supply that need. And then also, our school is decided in the last month to reorganize our administrative team. There's three of us, our director and the person who was the high school principal and myself. And so they're doing some reorganization. And just pray for God's wisdom to be in the middle of all that organization. And it was needed, and I'm glad it's happening, but it will be, change is always challenging, right? So I just pray that God will be in the middle of that reorganization, and that it will be for the betterment of the school. Thank you. Oh, and I have prayer cards out in the back, new prayer cards, so if you'd like to take one to remember to pray for me, I'd love to have you pray. That's how God works, is through our prayers. So thank you. Thanks for your prayers, your support, and for the opportunity to speak this morning.
Thank you, Vangie, for taking time to share with us a little bit more of what you're doing, and thank you for your prayers. They do make a difference. So we'll take some time now during our prayer time to pray for Vangie, but along with that, we want to invite you to share the prayer requests, praise items that you may have in the weeks ahead. Anything you'd like to share with us?
Morning. I'm going to ask you if you would invest something really precious. That's your time. To pray for us, Pamela and I and Linda are going to go to Sarka, Jordan in the 20th, we'll leave like the 22nd of June, and be done for about 10 days. If Zarka sounds familiar, there's a fellow by the name of Zarqawi that was leader of Al-Qaeda at one time, thought to be part of the 9/11 mastermind. He's from there. We're going to be doing an evangelistic English camp near Zarqa with international messengers. There's believers there. There's Christians there. And there, in order to come to this camp, they have to invite an unbelieving family to come with them. So we'll have Christians and unbelievers, probably Muslims, there at this camp that we will talk with about the gospel. And just ask you to pray. I got my fancy handwritten list here. I'll put it in the back, and I got 10 slots on there. That's international messengers. Requires that you have a prayer team before you go. So if you can invest, what it says is I will pray for Byron, Pamela, and Linda every day from June 22nd until July 3rd as they serve in Jordan sharing the gospel. So if you'd be willing to commit to that, would you sign this for me, please? So we can go knowing that we've got your backing. Thanks.
Thanks for sharing that, and we will be praying. prayer requests, praise items.
I'm leaving in a week to go on a 2-month-long mission trip to Panama. I'm a leader on the team, so I would really love for you guys to be praying for me to have wisdom, because I know this is going to be a really big challenge for me, and I'm just really excited to see what God's going to do.
Alright, thank you, Emma. So going to Panama in, it's in 1 week, but you're going to be gone for 2 weeks, right? Okay. 2 months. 2 months. Okay. We will pray. Other prayer requests. Alright, let's spend some time in prayer. And I know we've had a lot of sharing this morning, but there are days like this where we need these points of contact and be able to lift one another up. One other thing I will add, oh, we have one more here, but I'm going to add the Awana, we're doing a service project this year, and so there's a note in the prayer time about it. We're adding a bedroom and a bathroom and a basement for a family who is hosting another family through the immigration process. And so they're in two families in a 3-bedroom, 1-bathroom house and need a little extra space. So we're raising some funds as the three hosting Awana churches and working on that together. So just pray that that can come together well in a timely manner with building permits and all that. So appreciate your prayers. Dolores.
Thank you for praying for my sister-in-law, Linda Cron, and she is still in the Sioux Falls Hospital dealing with the mild heart attack and also the mild stroke. And so as a number of different things, she did have a procedure for the one artery on Wednesday for the heart. And they really need to do another, to give a stent for that. And there's really another one that they need to do. There's another blockage. Then dealing with both the stroke and the heart. She's been moved to a couple rooms in different areas of the hospital. And the hopes were to bring her to Good Sam on Friday or Monday, but it doesn't look like that's going to happen right now.
All right, so she's still working through things there. Great, thanks for sharing the update. All right, well, let's spend some time in prayer. And one more I did need to add. This morning, Nikki Peterson said she had been getting texts from her mom and dad who are traveling in Illinois, heading back to the cities, but her mom was having some pretty serious health issues, and then they stopped texting and commenting, so she was concerned they were having kind of a medical crisis. So pray for them, as just that they work through that well. Dear Lord, we lift all these things up to you, and I just want to thank you for the work that you're doing through Vangie there in Papua and Satani at Hillcrest International School. And Lord, we ask your spirit, we continue to move and work with power in the hearts and lives of each of the kids who come, Lord. You are doing a great thing. And we don't take it for granted that, Lord, each heart change is a work of your spirit. As your word is proclaimed through those who are faithfully serving you, walking with you, proclaiming that good news, Lord, we pray that you give them strength. Help them to be resting in you and living out that calling of who they are and their identity in you. And living a life of worship and praise to you as they build into others. So I pray that you'll equip the missionaries there to do your work in MAF, to carry those missionaries to their different fields of work. Lord, we thank you and praise you that you are a God who can move mountains. And it just blows our minds that you are God. Nothing is too great. Nothing is impossible for you. May we continue to believe that and live in that each and every day. And Lord, I pray that you'll guide her. And even as she goes through the visa process, trusting that you're at work, as she's shifting to more an administrator position, as she's visiting with accrediting these different schools, Lord, use her in a powerful way to do your work and carry out the proclamation of good news as it spreads. And pray for the Reynolds family as they continue to minister to the EFT people. Pray that you'll provide for Vangie the support she needs and continue to give her wisdom as the administrative team is reorganized and she makes the adjustments necessary. We also lift up Josh and Rachel to you as they were married yesterday, and just pray your blessing on their lives, their relationship together, just that they would live a life serving you, honoring you, walking closely with one another and with you, and glorifying you through their relationship. We also pray for Byron and Pam and Linda as they prepare to go to Jordan. But be preparing the way. We know that in some of these countries where the tensions can be high at times, we also can see your love and how it just can melt down walls and open hearts to the good news. And I pray that through their ministry there, that the love and the servant heart of Christ would come out, and that you would give them an ability to recognize how they can love and serve, and Lord, open the hearts of those who are there, especially those who don't know you, and that as an evangelistic camp, that it would be just a tool you would use to help the light of the gospel to spread with power. We pray for Emma as she prepares for Panama. Be preparing her heart, and as a leader, that she would have the boldness and the courage to lead well and to building into the lives of those on the team, to be caring for them and putting them first. Also, Lord, just give her insight and understanding into how to respond in situations she needs to. May her walk with you grow ever stronger, and her joy in you continue to shine through, even in the challenges and circumstances that they face. I pray, Lord, that you will equip and build her up for a life of ministry. I also pray for Nikki and her mom as Nikki's mom is traveling on the road and just has some health needs. Lord, intervene there. And Lord, we thank you that you are at work through all of us. As we go through this summer, may we have a heart willing to serve you, listening to where you call, opening our eyes to see the needs around us, whether through VBS or the outdoor adventures or whatever it is that comes, Lord, may we be investing in developing one another and serving you together. Thank you, because you have done that for us through Christ. In your name we pray. Amen.
You can stay seated as the ushers take the offering, but sing along with us as we go into our time of worship.
Thank you.
It's been so great to hear the exciting stories, exciting news of what God is doing. And so many things are happening here and around the world. Let's just praise Him. Praise Him this morning. Sing along and worship with us.
Time. Victorious.
Vangie, that's a powerful story. And the God who moves mountains literally is, I just want to just sit and just worship and praise Him. I stand in awe of that. I'm not going to take long. You guys are probably already looking at your clocks thinking, is Pastor going to preach? And I was just going to preach what I had prepared as my first point, but I don't even need to do that, do I? So I'm just going to stick this in here. And one of the things I want to just... So I'm writing a sermon in my head right now that will take 2 minutes. But, yeah. Do you guys have any mountains in your life? I think so often, as we go through life, we just get so used to God fitting in our box and doing what we can expect Him to do, and we don't expect Him to move mountains. And as you think through the scriptures, is God able to do that? Is God able to do that? And if you know the God we serve, that He is the Creator, and it said in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and He spoke by the very word of His mouth. These worlds were created, the heavens and the earth and everything it contained. That we have a God who is that powerful and that mighty and that awesome. Last week when I preached about how we are here to worship Him, that is one of our purposes. And as a church, that is our purpose in equipping, enabling you, pointing you to worship. And I feel like I don't want to miss this opportunity, once again, just to sit and worship our God, a God who can move mountains. And so often, because in our lives, we don't see that every day. And so when we face a mountain, you know, whether it's, you think through the stories of the Bible, and there's so many mountains that were moved from the children of Israel coming out of the promised land, or not out of the promised land, but out of Egypt. I mean, they were trapped in this mountain called Pharaoh and his army, and they were but slaves. And we had a God who moved a mountain and who delivered them and brought them out, who through the 10 plagues showed that He could do anything He needed to keep His promise to Abraham, to bring His people out of Egypt, and to put them in the promised land. And when they faced the promised land, there was another mountain. The Canaanites lived there, and they were big, and they were powerful, and they didn't want to go into the land. They wanted to stay in the comfort of the desert. Comfort? Desert? Doesn't make sense, but you know. Isn't that where we're at times? As we face these mountains in front of us, but the desert we're in looks better, so we think, God, I just want to stay here. But He's calling us. He's calling us to something greater. And when we lose sight of living a life of worship, and we don't want to follow Him, we get stuck in those deserts, and we wander for years. And He's calling us to come beyond that. And to keep that proper view of God. That God is, you know, the PowerPoint says, God is strong. He is stronger. He can move the mountain. One of the verses I've been thinking about for VBS is that, you know, the theme is Maker Fun Factory. And it's that we have a maker and a designer. He created us this way. But He's created us to be dependent on Him. He's created us that way. So what does He want us to do? He wants us to come and say, God, we need You. But then the second day, it's about God is for us. When He created us as finite beings, as jars of clay, it wasn't so that we could just say, man, God, I can't do everything. What's wrong with You? Well, nothing's wrong with Him. It's there's something wrong with us, and we need Him. And that God is for us. God is for us. Who can be against us? God is strong. And so in the mountains that you face, keep turning to God. That's a powerful story, and I'm sure I'm going to tell that one again. But we have a God who can move mountains. And He is for you. And that's what Romans 8, chapter 8 says. If God is for us, who can be against us? We are more than conquerors. How? Through Christ, who loved us and gave Himself up for us. He has moved the mountain of our sin that separates us from an infinite, perfectly holy God. Because as an infinite, holy sacrifice, he could pay that price. And he says, now you are mine. You are mine. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation for my own possession to declare the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. So go. Proclaim his greatness. Worship him fully. Proclaim him mightily because of who he is in the week ahead. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you that we can praise you, we can worship you, we can honor you as a holy God. Lord, forgive me because I forget that. I forget that, Lord. And I think it's by my might and my power that things get done, and they don't. And so I get frustrated, Lord. Even this week, I have an evening of frustration. Forgive me. Because I don't live in light of you, of your greatness, of your power. It's by your Spirit that this mountain will be moved. Lord, help us not to take matters into our own hands. Help us not to fret about the things that we can't do. And even after working for 3 years, day and night, rock by rock, by the sweat of our brow, when it doesn't turn out like we want, Lord, may we trust you. That we are here to work and to glorify you and to serve you, but Lord, it's not by our strength that it gets done, it's by yours. And so may we remember each and every day that you are for us, not against us. And may we be clinging to you as that God who loves us, who's created us, who has a plan for us. And just as you have moved mountains in the past to carry out your plan, and Lord, as we read even the book of Revelation, we see you are going to move mountains in the future to carry out your plan, even today. It is not beyond you to move a mountain. As your people, in your name, are serving you and carrying out your work, as we choose to follow after you, Lord, as we lean on you and knock and seek and ask, but we ask in your name, doing your will, you can do what we would consider impossible. Lord, we ask you to do that. In our lives today, align us with you, with your character, with your will, that we live each day in your name, and that we see your power at work in us. Because it's not of us, it's of you. May we be filled with your Spirit, proclaiming your name, building up your people, your work in your power. Your